We talked about the showcase. We talked about Spider-Man. But now let's get into our thoughts on the pricing. Malik, take it away.
All right. So we got the official prices for the PlayStation 5 and the digital edition. For the normal edition, it'll be $499 USD. And then for the digital edition, it's going to be $399 USD. Pre-orders were supposed to go out 24 hours after the PlayStation showcase had ended. As we now know, that is not the case. Links started going live all over from a variety of public or outlets where people could go and pre-order their PlayStation 5s. Unfortunately, I don't think that PlayStation was ready for this because it seemed like they were scrambling. There wasn't any tweets that came out from them. There was no official messaging. And as we kind of talked about a little bit in our break, it was Walmart where they were the first outlet to kind of let these PlayStation 5 pre-orders go through. And Walmart has a pretty bad track record of leaking things when they're not supposed to be. How do you guys feel about how the PlayStation pre-order debacle kind of went about?
I think it was bad. I'll tell you, even if they were going on schedule, to have the pre-orders go up one day after the showcase, they said months ago when there were a lot of rumors. I mean, we were talking about it on the show. I remember you guys know when I was hearing like a lot of people talking online how, oh, the pre-orders might go live on this more random day. And then it didn't end up happening. And then I remember there was an interview with Jeff Keighley and a member working at PlayStation. I can't remember who exactly it was, but the person at PlayStation, they said, we don't know where those rumors are coming from about pre-orders. We will give you guys ample notice on when you can pre-order our console. And I still think one day is not enough notice. Yeah. For me to be ready to pre-order the console.
I think one day could work if we are aware that if they tweeted ahead in that week, PlayStation pre-orders coming soon, or like stay tuned for pre-order information, teasing it. I think revealing it, then having it open would have been fine. The most confusing thing. Okay, go ahead.
Another problem is there was no time provided even when they said that they would be coming as soon as tomorrow. You look at what Xbox did, and maybe what Xbox did was clearly in reaction to the disaster of PlayStation. They were like, well, we can take serious advantage of this.
Yes.
But still, you look at what Xbox did. They were like, here's the day. Here's the time. That's when you can pre-order.
Yes.
For some reason, that wasn't provided for PlayStation. And then on top of that, the pre-orders went live the day of instead of a day later.
I think the most confusing thing of this is the fact that Jeff Keighley had more information about pre-orders than anybody else in the industry, even PlayStation. Yeah. Like, I feel like a lot of people were finding out information on how to find a PlayStation 5 was from Jeff Keighley tweeting, like, I've confirmed with Sony that this is coming out this and it's going to be available. Like, it's like, why are we getting that news from Jeff Keighley and not from PlayStation themselves? I think that might be attributed to the idea that this whole showcase was not supposed to happen as early as it did. It was planned for a later date. I think that because of the response to Xbox revealing their price, and you know, we talked about this last week of PlayStation needing to come out and respond quickly to the price reveal of the Xbox Series X, it was just now all of the other stuff that they might have had an oversight on or not communicated to the other stores that would be providing the PlayStation 5 pre-orders. This, I think, was a result of that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I think the big conspiracy theory, but it's okay. I think that they had this recorded before Xbox did their announcement. I think that it was pre-recorded because a lot of the messaging and the titles and the dates seemed very vague. I think that they were just waiting for Xbox to pull the trigger first, and then they scheduled it after. But I don't think that there was any real sort of preparation for it, because especially since I was one of the few people who got one of those links where it was like you can sign up early to pre-order the PlayStation 5. But those people didn't get any sort of extra warning. It was just the PlayStation 5 is available for pre-order randomly wherever you can find a link. And sure, if that was their plan of action, it could have been massively successful if they did it right, if they opened up a select few the day after, you know, whoever got those links. And then maybe the following week, this week, there was, you know, it was open to the general public. But like you said, Caboose, I think it was just a train wreck of reactionary measures of, oh, well, they're going live, so we're going to go live with our link. And then PlayStation is just kind of reeling to get in control. But it doesn't make sense why Jeff Keighley was the one giving all of the information.
I don't understand that at all.
Like, why was my big question is, why was PlayStation going to him, or why was he having to confirm? That's what seems weird. Why not?
I understand him having to confirm. Like, I think a lot of media outlets, influencers, journalists were messaging PlayStation, like, wait, we have all these questions that were not answered from the showcase. Can you give us answers? It's just weird that PlayStation was only answering him. Because I love Jeff Keighley, everything he's done, the fact that he's Canadian, all that stuff, but it kind of skews that, his place in the industry of, you know, legitimacy of the Game Awards. Like, it just kind of makes it hard to differentiate him from the developers. I do want to talk specifically about the price point, because I think we mentioned before, I was looking at maybe spending, you know, $700-$800 Canadian for that PlayStation. And it looks like their price point was pretty comparable to the Series X and kind of what I was hoping to expect.
Yeah, and it's really not that far off. So just for reference, the Xbox Edition X, it's a Series X. It's called
Series X,
right?
X, yeah.
Okay, I get Xbox confused.
There's so many X's and S's and letters.
Yeah, so their next generation hard drive console is going to be $499, but then the discless version,
which is the same price as the PlayStation 5, yeah.
Yep. And US, then the discless version is going to be $299 USD, so $100 less than PlayStation's version.
But their discless version is not, like, so PlayStation, from my understanding, the PlayStation 5 digital edition is a full-fledged PlayStation 5, just without the disc, whereas the Xbox Series S, Series S, I'm trying to get all the letters right, it does have a few downgrades as well.
Mm-hmm. And I think that's going to be, I don't think Microsoft has really clearly stated that in their marketing, that the edition or the Series S is going to be downgraded. I think that they're marketing it just like PlayStation is, where these are two comparable consoles, but just one's missing a disc drive. And I think that, not misguided marketing, but, you know, kind of shying away from that detail that it is a downgraded, might help Xbox. We also have the recent news, I don't know, Camille, if you want to bring it up, about Bethesda and Xbox. Because PlayStation announced, I mean, at the end of their press conference.
Yeah, you go ahead. Because I think after the showcase, we thought, you know, PlayStation had this in the bag, right? Yeah. Or at least, okay, they're making a stance, a great response to Xbox and their reveal of their price point and their last reveal, their showcase.
Right. And then we can't also forget that they do have the PlayStation Plus collection, which is aiming to be their kind of Xbox Game Pass. It's got Battlefield 1, Days Gone, Detroit Becoming Human, God of War, Bloodborne, Monster Hunter, Fallout, a whole bunch of different games.
Arkham Knight.
A lot of those PlayStation exclusives that, you know, people who didn't own a PlayStation would hear their friends that had PlayStations talking about. So it does give a lot of opportunity for people if they're going to be new to PlayStation. Maybe that's what PlayStation was doing by offering this collection. It's like you could catch up on all those exclusives that will get you excited to be a PlayStation owner, because we got more of these exclusives coming. However, I have to disagree with you, Malik. I don't think it was an answer to Game Pass, just because I feel like if it was, I would have wanted to see what I've been asking for so long from PlayStation, bundling PlayStation Now with PlayStation well, in this collection. So you have just one membership fee that gives you all of these benefits and you're getting more games in your library. And we're not getting that. It's still unclear, especially if this collection will be available. Like, there's so many questions around this collection. Is this going to be a continuing subscription? Because it said at no added price of PlayStation Plus. But what does that really mean? Is this library of games going to be growing? Are they going to be available? I think they're all available at launch, but then is it going to be added more exclusives every month? Is it going to be one game added? You know, so we need that clarity.
Yeah. And I don't, as a PlayStation fanboy, this is going to be hard for me to admit, but Sony and PlayStation are awful at services. They've always copied what Microsoft and Xbox have done, because when multiplayer went free on Xbox, they were like, oh, I guess we'll go free. And then when, or it was free on PlayStation, Xbox charged, started charging, and then they decided that they were going to charge. Now Xbox has their Game Pass and they're starting to realize, well, we've got to do something to get us on that same level. People forget that PlayStation used to have a TV network series that failed awfully. PlayStation Now, when it first came out, they had a lot of issues with lag and those kind of server side issues. I agree with you. I think that PlayStation Now needs to get to a place where it can either stand on its own or be included into this PlayStation Plus collection. Because I don't know a single person who plays or has subscribed to PlayStation Now. I don't think it's a...
Yeah.
I don't think it's a... Because I could... I mean, if we're... You're subscribed to it?
Yeah, I have a PlayStation. Yes, because I play like, so I love my PlayStation 1, but of course, hooking up a PlayStation 1 to a TV now, you need all these different cords to convert over. So one of those games that I spent so much time with was Harvest Moon as a kid. Oh, so for me, playing on PlayStation Now and paying that membership is just for a lot of Harvest Moon time. There are some great games too, like some Cartoon Network games. Ben 10, you know, I do play some of their Cartoon Network games because they are great quality games too. So that for me is actually great. I feel like there is some games that are there. I do wish you could download all of them. Some of them have to be streamed off the service and you cannot download. But I do think there's a great library of games there that are not explored for the reasons you said. Like, I feel like it's not promoted as much. I don't think PlayStation really knows what they want to do with that service. And if they were able to bundle it in with PlayStation Plus, so you have that, if you need an online membership for whatever game you're playing online, you also get PlayStation Now, kind of what Xbox did with Live, then you have now two comparable services. I think that's the right move for PlayStation.
I think PlayStation doesn't really need to be panicking just yet about Xbox Game Pass. I still think that they got a lot of people in their pocket still. And for the most part, especially considering the delay of Halo and you know, just a lack of exclusives coming out at launch. And I mean, you look at the launch lineup for PlayStation, they got, although Spider-Man's coming to PS4, they got Spider-Man Miles Morales with the remaster, and that's only on PS5, the remaster. They got Demon's Souls, they got Ratchet and Clank in the release window. So like having those heavy hitters, having new games is definitely going to be a big sell for a lot of people to get PlayStation 5s. And I don't think they right now need to panic about Game Pass. I think eventually Game Pass is going to be a big enough competitor for Xbox to stay in the race. And once it starts getting to that point, you're probably going to see Sony be like, okay, here's how we've now redone and remodeled PlayStation Now. And then we'll see how it goes from there. But I'm pretty sure, especially considering if we're talking about the price points and everything, especially considering the fact that they didn't announce a price plan, a payment plan, the way that Xbox did, considering that clearly Xbox still is the cheapest console, I don't think PlayStation's really all that worried about the console generation. I think they're still very calm, cool, and collective about it. So we'll see how it plays out over the next couple of years. But right now, like Xbox is doing the right things. Like, they know, as of right now at least, they can't compete on the exclusives. Yeah.
I mean, isn't this
unless they make Elder Scrolls 6 an exclusive, then it's interesting.
And that's the thing. I think after this whole showcase, we're like, PlayStation's made its mark. And then we wake up this morning to the crazy news no one expected. I think it's going to be the tops, one of the top stories, if not the top story in gaming for the year, is that Xbox has bought Bethesda.